Hi, in the last class we have studied Lagrange's theorem and one of its corollaries. Today we have to discuss one theorem on as an application of Lagrange's theorem. Before that, in order to discuss that theorem, we need to get an understanding of this order of an element. So, define order of an element. This is already discussed in the previous classes. So, I write a group G. Let G be a group, an arbitrary group. So, this need not be finite or infinite. It need not be finite group. This is an arbitrary group. Okay. Let A belongs to G. We know that this G is always non-empty because the definition of G asserts that this G is non-empty. So, if you choose any element belongs to G, you can construct the cyclic subgroup generated by that element. Okay? So, this consists of the elements A raised to 0, A raised to 1, A raised to 2, etc. And here we have A raised to minus 1. A raised to minus 2, etc. So these are the elements of this group, this subgroup. Okay, so it is the smallest subgroup. So it's called it's a subgroup generated by A. So this is also called, or this is the subgroup, this is the smallest subgroup of G containing A. Okay. This is also the smallest subgroup of G containing A. In the sense that if any subgroup of G contains A, should contain this these elements. Okay, so every subgroup of G containing A contains this subgroup. That's the meaning of the smallest. Okay, in that sense we can say that this is the smallest one. This cardinality of this subgroup is called the order of an element. Okay, so the cardinality of this subgroup is defined as the order of A, the element A in G. So every element of G has order. If this is finite, then we can say that A is of finite order. Otherwise, we can say that A is of infinite order. So what is the cardinality of this A is called the order of A. Okay, cardinality of this subgroup is called cardinality of A. Lagrange's theorem, we can get a easy corollary for this. That is termed as theorem 10.12. The statement is order of an element of a finite group divides the order of the group. The order of an element of a finite group divides the order of the group. Okay, so this is immediate consequence of Lagrange's theorem, because the definition itself says that when you apply Lagrange's theorem on the definition of order of an element, we can get the conclusion. So how will you prove this order of an element divides order of the group? So one thing you should remember is this theorem holds only for finite groups. Okay, so if we are taking infinite group, then we cannot apply this theorem. Okay. So now we start with an order of the element. Let for the proof, we start with a finite group. let cardinality of G be n and A belongs to G. We need to prove that order of A. Order of A is defined as this symbol, order of A. Order of A is cardinality of the subgroup. Then we will prove that that number divides this order of G. So before that, we can recall the Lagrange theorem of Lagrange. That is, the statement of Lagrange's theorem is, if G is finite group, then order of every subgroup, order of each subgroup divides the order of group, divides the order of G, divides the order of G. That means H is any subgroup, then order of H divides order of G. So if we start with cardinality of G is equal to N and A belongs to G, so this implies there is a subgroup generated by A which is fully contained in G. Since this subgroup is contained in G, or this is a subgroup of G, using this Lagrange's theorem you can say that cardinality of the subgroup, let it be H, then cardinality of H divides cardinality of G. So cardinality of the subgroup divides the cardinality of G. Okay, and the cardinality of this subgroup is defined as order of A. So order of any element divides cardinality of G. So this is the proof of theorem 10.12. And after this, you can see one definition that we have already discussed in the last class: index of a subgroup in the group G. Okay, so I'll write that definition. 10.13 definition. This is the definition of index. Index of a subgroup. Index of a subgroup. The statement is, let H be a subgroup of G. Let H be any subgroup, need not be finite. H be any subgroup of G. We have discussed last class the subgroup 3 is a double set. Both are infinite, even though the number of distinct cosets is finite. In that case, there are only 3 distinct left cosets for 3z in z. So even though the group and subgroups are infinite, the number of distinct subgroups need not be infinite. Okay, so this is a definition for arbitrary subgroup. Let H be a subgroup of G. The number of left cosets of H, this is the definition, the number of left cosets. You can replace this left by right, because each left coset corresponds to the corresponding right coset. So need not be equal, but there is a 1-1 correspondence between set of all left cosets to set of all right cosets. That means the cardinality of both sets are the same. So this is the number of left cosets of H in G is the index. Is the index. Index is denoted by this symbol, is the index GH. We are using the symbol bracket. Yesterday I have written the square bracket. Instead of square bracket, you can use this symbol bracket or open parenthesis. This is the symbol for the index. Index of H in G. So please make a note on this. This is the symbol for index of H in G. This is not H colon G. This is called G colon H. Okay, this is the annotation for index of the subgroup. Now we have a remark on these two things, theorem we have proved here and this definition. If you are considering a finite group, if G is finite, whenever every subgroup is finite, then the number of distinct left cosets is obtained by the equation order of G by order of H. that we have discussed yesterday. So this is going to be the index of h in g. Okay, so this is the formula for finding the index of a subgroup in g if g is finite. So please make a note on this formula, order of g by order of h. This is only for finite groups. You cannot get this formula for this infinite group. Okay, so now we can prove the last theorem of this section, section 10. This is 10.14, theorem 10.14. This theorem says some recurrence relation between groups and subgroups on this index. Okay, so the statement is, let H and K are subgroups of G such that K is a subgroup of H and which is a subgroup of G. Okay, and suppose also that the index of H in K, as we consider H is a group, K is a subgroup of H, and index of H in G, that is written as this. This is the index of H in G, are both finite. Our hypothesis is we have two subgroups for G, H and K, in which this K is a subgroup of H again. Then you assume that index of K in H and index of H in G, both are finite. Okay, if this is the case, then you can conclude that the index of K in G, since this K is a subgroup of H and H is a subgroup of G, then using the transitivity property, this K is a subgroup of G as well. Okay, so we can consider the index of K in G. Okay, so this index of K in G is also finite. This is the conclusion. Index of K is finite. Moreover, you can evaluate this index using the indices H in K in H and H in G. So the index of K in G is nothing but index of G in H into index of H in K. Sorry, index of K in H. Okay, so using these formula, you can evaluate this finite index. So this is the last theorem for this this session. Now we can prove this theorem. Proof. To prove this, we need to find out the number of distinct lefty cosets of K in G. Okay, that will be same as the number of product of these two things. Okay, so we start with, we are given that these two quantities are finite. So we start with this. The meaning of index of H in G is that distinct lefty cosets of H in G is finite. Okay, so I assume let the set A1 H, A2 H, etc., AN H be the set of all B, the set of all distinct lefty cosets of H in G. What is the meaning of this? The meaning of this statement is, if you consider A1 H union A2 H union etc. union AN H will give G. Okay, that means the union of distinct lefty cosets will be G, because this form of partition. Okay, that means union is G, and intersection will be, pairwise intersection will be empty. That is AIH intersection AJH will be empty. It's an empty set for I not equal to J. Okay. This is the consequence of index of H in G is finite. Similarly, index of K in H is finite. So we start with set of all distinct cosets of K in H. Say B1K, B2K, etc. BMK. Okay, this is the set of all with the set of all distinct left cosets. Distinct left cosets of K in H. That is, as a consequence, we can write this is B1K union B2K union etc. union BMK will give H, because K is a subgroup of H. Okay. So if you write the cosets of K in H, then you can get union as H inside. Here H is a subgroup of G, then union of cosets of H will give G. Okay. So here we have BIK intersection BJK is empty. Okay, for I not equal to J. Now this is the hypothesis. So now we can prove that the left cosets of K in G can be obtained from these two sets. Okay, so our claim is the set of all A I B J K. Again, you consider all the elements of the form A I B J. So these are m times n in number. Okay, nm is the cardinality of the elements of this AIBJ. Okay, so such that I 1 less than or equal to I less than or equal to n, 1 less than or equal to j less than or equal to n. Our claim is this set is the set of all distinct left cosets of K in G. Okay, so what is the consequence? This set has cardinality MN. Okay, so NM or MN will be, so we can write index of K in G will be MN. Okay, or NM, obviously NM. Okay, because this is the current of the set is NM. And what is N? N is the number of distinct left cosets of H. So this will be index of H in G, and M will be index of K in G, K in H. Okay, so this proves this theorem. So it remains to prove that this set is a set of all distinct left cosets of K in G. That means we need to prove that union of all these sets will be G, and each of these are pairwise disjoint. Okay, so that is what we have to prove. That is A1 B1 K union A1 B2 K union etc. Union A1 BM K union A2 B1 K union etc. union, last one is ANBMK. We need to prove that this is our G, and each of these sets are pairwise disjoint. Okay, so first of all we have to prove this set is G. Obviously union of these are all subsets of G, because every element comes from this G. Therefore one implication is very trivial: this LHS is contained in G. Okay, and we need to prove that the other inclusion. So if we start with X belongs to G, okay, we have already written that union of A1H, A2H etc. are all G. So if we choose any element from G, then that element will be an element of the left hand side of this equation. That means that there should exist at least one AIH such that this X is a number AIH, because the union of these are nothing but G. Now this set is nothing but AIH1, AI, H2, etc., etc. We can never expect that this set is finite, because it may not be finite. Okay, we haven't given that this H is a finite set, so we assume it's an infinite set. But AI H can be defined as AI times H1, AI times H2, and so on. Okay, then X belongs to AI H means X is a member of this set. So what is the implication of this? X can be written as AI times some H. Some H belongs to H. Some H belongs to H. Yeah. And we know that X equal to AI H and H belongs to H. We know that union of these cosets are H. So if we choose any element of this H, then that element will be an element of union of these, all these. So there exist at least one coset from this cosets of K which contains H. So H belongs to some B, J, K. Okay? So consequently, we have X equal to A, I, H, and that H can be written as B, J, some K. Okay. So what is the implication of this? Using these two equations, you can write X as A, I times B, J times some K. And this K belongs to capital K. So therefore, this is an element of AI, BJ, K. This K is a set. This is an element. So AI, BJ, some K is an element of this set, because this set is nothing but AI, BJ, K1, AI, BJ, K2, and so on. Okay, so this X will be an element of this set. So we can say that X belongs to the union. Okay, so that is union AI BJ K. So this proves the other inclusion. So which shows that union is G. So our claim is the first part of our claim is true. Okay, secondly, we need to prove that these are all distinct. Okay, so these sets are distinct. That means if we choose two arbitrary cosets from this collection, then we will prove that those two things are entirely different, or its intersection is empty. Okay, so that is, so it is easy to show that whenever this set, if we prove this to these cosets are distinct, then you can say that this is set of all distinct left cosets of G, because we have already proved the equality this. Okay. For that we take arbitrary cosets, say A, P, B, Q, K, and A, R, B, S, K. We will prove that these are distinct. Distinct sets. If this or we prove if this is equal to this left coset equal to this, then we will prove that this P is same as R and Q is same as S. Okay, that means all these are distinct. Whenever these two are equal, then this will be the same one. P will be equal to R and Q will be equal to S. So if possible assume these two cosets are equal, okay, then we can easily prove that this P equal to R and Q equal to S. Then we can say that every element of these are distinct. This implies we know that BJs are, or BQs and BS are, comes from H. Okay, so that's what we have constructed here. These are the left cosets of K in H. So these BIs are all elements of H. So we can say that this collection is always contained in H. Similarly, this components are elements of or contained in H. So we can say that this implies this BK. Okay, this belongs to APH, okay, contained in, or we can say that this is you can say that this element is contained in APH, and this element is contained in AQH. Okay, so that is the implication. What is the implication? AP, or I will write here, AP BQ K is contained in APH. Okay, because this factor is contained in H, and AR BS K is contained in AR H, because this is contained in H. Yeah, that this part is contained in H. So what is the meaning of this? If you consider these two things, these two sets, these are sets. In fact, these are the elements of this set is nothing but A P B Q K 1, A P B Q K 2, and so on. So that is this set. Okay. So we can say that this B Q times K 1 is an element of H. So you can write it as some H I and or H 1 prime. And this is again element of H, so we can replace this by some H2 prime, etc. So that is the the meaning of that is this set is contained in APH1, APH2, APH3, and so on. That means that is contained in APH. Okay, that is the meaning of this. If you observe the elements of the set, you can get this is contained in APH. Now we can say that APH contains common element. Our assumption is these two things are same. So this set, the elements of this set and elements of this set are the same. So that is those elements contained in APH and ARH as well. But as a consequence of this, you can write APH contains the elements which is in ARH. That means the intersection need not be empty. Okay. So this is non-empty intersection. What is the meaning of this? We have selected these APH and ARH are the distinct left cosets of H. Okay, so but intersection is non-empty. That means these two things are the same. We know that distinct cosets are disjoint. Okay, therefore APH, because these are the equivalent classes. So if there is an intersection between these two equivalent classes, we can expect that those equivalent classes are the same. So this implies AP equal to AR, consequently P is equal to R. Okay, because these are the distinct, so these two quantities should be the same one, otherwise this will be empty. Okay, so P equal to R. Now we can get now we have to prove that this whenever this happens, we need to prove that this P is equal to R and Q is equal to S. Okay, so here we prove the first part, P is equal to R. Next we will prove Q is equal to S. To prove this Q is equal to S, we observe a consequence from this statement, AP equal to AR. That means AR inverse AP, that will give the identity element. Okay, so this is the things from AP equal to AR. Now we will prove this BQ is Q is equal to S. That is because BQK, this BQK can be written as this AR inverse AP. This is an identity element. When you operate elements of this set to identity element, that will give the same set. So BQK is same as identity times this. Okay, so because this is identity. So when you operate every element of the set with identity, you will get the same set. Then you can write it as AR inverse AP BQK. You can associate using the associated property, and our assumption is AP BQ K is equal to, we have already assumed that AP BQ is K is equal to AR BSK. So we write that this is AR inverse, and instead of this we write AR BSK. We have replaced this by this quantity, and we can again, using the associative property, this is AR inverse AR using this associating these two BSK, you can write it as this is BSK because this is identity element. AR inverse AR is equal to identity. So that is same as BS times K. Now we have BQ times K equal to BS times K, and we have chosen these are distinct cosets. Okay, but whenever these two are equal, we can get this BQ and BS are the same. Consequently, Q equal to S. Yeah. Now we can say that these two cosets are same. AP BQ K is equal to AR BS equal to K. When you assume this, that means these two cosets are equal. Then we can get P equal to R and Q equal to S. So whenever what is the contrapositive of this? Whenever P not equal to R or Q not equal to S, we have AP BQ K not equal to AR BS K. That means these are all distinct. Okay, so we can say that the set of all A I B J K were 1 less than or equal to I less than or equal to N, 1 less than or equal to J less than or equal to M is the set of all distinct left cosets of K in G. Consequently, index of K in G is equal to N times M, and this N is nothing but index of H in G, and M is equal to index of K in H. Okay, so this proves the theorem, and there are easy proof for this if that G is finite. Okay, so please note this remark. Remark is, if G is finite, cardinality of G is N, then this can be written as index G K, that is index of K in G. Index of K in G is nothing but cardinality of G by cardinality of K, if this is finite. Okay, in this case you can write this is cardinality of G by cardinality of H, and cardinality of H divided by cardinality of K. You can insert these cardinality of H in the numerator and denominator, and the first term, the first quantities, the first fraction termed as index of G, index of H in G, and this will be index of K in H. Okay, so this we can easily prove this. This is only if this is finite, but in our theorem it is not assumed that G is finite. Okay, that's why we had a lengthy proof. Okay, so please note on this. With this we can come to the end of section 10, and the next class we will start section 11, that is the last section of second module. Okay, thank you.